Bam, this is true. Taking a look at part two of doing the partial fraction decomposition, undoing that addition of algebraic fractions. And remember, we can do this when the degree of the numerator is less than the degree of the denominator. So we had part one, which dealt with the denominator having linear factors. Now, what if they are quadratic? The partial fraction decomposition of p of x over q of x, when q of x has a non-repeated prime quadratic factor. And now I'm kind of repeating myself here. If a times x squared plus bx plus c is a prime quadratic factor of q of x, the partial decomposition will contain a term, and there can be a linear term as well, but for that part that is quadratic, that partial decomposition will contain a term of the form ax plus b, so over ax squared plus bx plus c. Now note, when we had linear factors down here, as I put there, when we had linear factors down the denominator, our numerators were constant, or had a degree of one less. Whereas when our denominator is a quadratic, ax plus b is a linear factor, so that numerator is having a degree that's less than the denominator, and actually specifically by one. So keep that in mind. We'll be recalling case one and case two in possibly in our examples, because we don't necessarily just have to have quadratic factors in our denominators. So let's get to our third example if you're watching both of these videos, or the first example where a denominator is a quadratic. So here are our example. Now, I've not given you an example that's boom, ready to go, like some of the easier ones would be in your textbook. I'm giving us a denominator that has a power of 3. Now, any exponent or any power larger than 2 is really quite difficult to deal with. Sometimes these will factor by grouping, this one will not. So remember, you might want to look up solving higher order equations if you've forgotten how to take care of this exponent of 3, because remember, we're only dealing with denominators that have factors that are linear and factors which are quadratic. So this quadratic, it does have a factor. We're going to be able to take a linear factor out of it, but we will not be able to factor it out. We'll have to use the rational, what was it called again? Rational zero root theorem, where you take all the factors of the constants, which are the constant, which is 1 and 5, along with all the factors of the leading coefficient, and you put factors of the constant over the factors of the leading coefficient, and our possible rational zeros are plus or minus 1 over 1 and 5 over 1. So if we were to, if I was teaching this whole process to you from scratch, I'd be talking about how you do trial and error with all of your possible ones, possible rational zeros. There's Descartes' rule to shortcut the process a little bit. I already know what the answer is going to be, so I just want to just show you this, remind you really quick. 1 will synthetically divide evenly out of this quadratic, so we're going to take the coefficients here of 1, negative 4, positive 8, and negative 5. Synthetically divide that out, we're going to bring down the 1, and then multiply. 1 times 1 is 1, and then we're going to add negative 4 and 1 is negative 3, and multiply. Positive 8 plus negative 3 is 5, and then multiply again and get positive 5, and a remainder of 0. When you get a remainder of 0, remember, that means that you found a place where this equation crosses the x-axis. Or in other words, I found a factor of x cubed minus 4x squared plus 8x minus 5, and we have this. This, since it's a third degree, we get a result that is 1x squared minus 3x plus 5 when I add the variables back in. And our constant that was able to come out evenly was 1, so our factor of this cubic function here, this cubic denominator, is x minus 1. So this is the factored form of this cubic expression or cubic denominator. So we do have a unique linear factor, and we have a prime, one unique prime quadratic factor. Okay, so that means that this becomes 3x squared plus 14x plus 10 over x minus 1 times x squared minus 3x plus 5. And now we're at the point where most of your questions are probably going to be given to you in your textbook, where we have our denominator already factored out, because, you know, trying to factor cubics, again, difficult, rarely happens. You don't want to be doing, hopefully your textbook author is not expecting to do all that synthetic division and trial and error with the rational zero root theorem to get those denominators broken down. But it is a quick little review there for you. So we're going to get, well, we have a linear factor, so we're going to put a constant over that linear factor, so we're going to have a over x minus 1 plus, and we have a prime quadratic. So we're going to go to the next constant we have available, which is, well, at least in letter form, b, and write bx plus c over x squared minus 3x plus 5. We're now going to multiply through this entire equation, the lowest common multiple, the lowest common denominator. Basically just take these factors of x minus 1 and x squared minus 3x plus 5 all the way through these terms. And when we do that, this is all going to cancel out, and we get 3x squared plus 14x plus 10. The x minus 1's cancel out, and we get a times x squared minus 3x plus 5 plus, now our x squared, our quadratics are going to cancel out, giving us bx, make sure you watch the parentheses here, bx plus c times x minus 1. Okay, keep working on this. We have this a getting multiplied through the parentheses, so we have ax squared minus 3ax plus 5a. The bx plus c has to be foiled with the, or distributed with the x minus 1, so we have bx times x is bx squared, and now we got negative bx and positive cx and negative c. Okay, we're going to get all of our powers of 2 together, our power linear terms together, and our constants together. So we have ax squared plus bx squared minus 3ax minus bx plus cx, make sure I don't make any mistakes here, plus 5a minus c. Now, all these groupings where we have the common powers, that common variable has to get canceled, or not canceled out, but factored out. So we're going to have a plus b x squared plus negative 3a minus b plus c with the x taken out, and then plus, and the parentheses just for highlighting, 5a minus c. Okay, I'm starting to run out of space, but what we're going to do on the next screen is I'm putting these coefficients together. So I'm going to match the 3 with the a plus b, and the 14 with the constant of x on the right-hand side, which is negative 3a minus b plus c. And then finally, the 10 with our grouping of generic constants of 5a minus c. And let's get this cleaned up and see what that looks like. So, got some room to work down. We got 3 equations and 3 unknowns. So, we could potentially have a huge amount of work to get these 3 unknowns solved and finish our question. But thankfully, some of these equations only have 2 variables in them, so it's not going to be quite as much work as we might, you know, initially fear. Row 2 and row 3 already have opposite coefficients in front of c, and the first equation doesn't have the value of c in it, the first row, the first set of, equation, whatever. So we're going to take row 1, or just take this first row, a plus b equals 3, And what we're going to do is I'm going to combine that with the addition of row 2 plus row 3. You know, just using the notation you might have seen me use for my couple of videos about solving three-variable systems. And when I add these equations, I have negative 3 plus 5, which is going to be 2a, negative b plus 0, which is negative b, whoops, that's not c, that's 3, okay? And positive c plus negative c, those cancel out, and we have 14 plus 10, which is equal to 24. So I've gone from three equations and three unknowns, and with only one step, I've gone to two equations and two unknowns. And really, really nicely, I again already have a pair of opposite values in front of my variable b. So now what I'm going to do is simply add these two equations again. Let's just call it row 1 plus row 2, and we get a plus 2a is equal to 3a. Positive b and negative b cancel out to be 0, so that's equals, and then 3 times 24 is 27. And then divide both sides by 3, and a is equal to 9. Okay? Let's start back substituting to find the other equations. If a is equal to 9, then let's pick a different color for the next back substitution. We're going to take this first equation here and get, follow the arrows, a is 9 plus b is equal to 3, subtract both sides by 9, and b is equal to negative 6. And just because this question is so long, I want to make sure I don't make any mistakes. Okay. Now, let's pick a different color. Let's back substitute again, and we need to find the value of c, the constant of c. And I can use either the second or third equation if this is supposed to be a unique solution of the entire system. So I'll pick the one that requires least amount of work, and that is the third one, 5a, which came out to be 9, minus c equals 10. That's going to be 45, minus c equals 10, subtract both sides by 45, and we get negative c equals negative 35, or c is equal to positive 35. Now, if you want to make sure that you haven't made any mistakes, you have to take all three of these constants and plug them into each of these three equations that are in your system to make sure that these three constants, these three solutions that we think we have, work for all three, which I just kind of cheated and did on my calculator, and they are going to be okay. So now I'm just going to take my constants and plug them back into my partial fraction decomposition. So let's go ahead and do that. We had an a value of 9. We have a b value of negative 6. And we have a c value supposedly of 35. And we can also check our work by simply taking, you know, what we now believe we have 3x squared plus 14x minus 10 over x minus 1 times x squared minus 3x plus 5. And we can take these two equations and add them together to make sure that they add up indeed to the original problem that we had. It does, so I'm done. Bam! Moving on to the last case. Case number 4. Bam! Last case, case number 4. Ah! Drop our remote. Okay, the partial fraction decomposition of a rational expression with a prime repeated quadratic factor in the denominator is p of x over ax squared plus bx plus c to the n power. And again, this is only specific for that repeated quadratic. Like the last example, we had a linear factor and a quadratic together in the same denominator. Well, you're going to write out that repeated, whoops, garbage can. We're going to write out that quadratic to the power of 1 with a sub 1 x plus b sub 1 plus that quadratic again, but now with the next higher power, we're going to count up by 1 with our powers until we get to whatever that exponent is or that power, is on our quadratic. So we got an exponent of 1, now we have an exponent or power of 2, and just keep adding by 1s, hopefully there's not very many of them, until you get to whatever that power is that's on that bottom quadratic factor. That's prime. And we're not going to write a sub 1, b sub 1, a sub 2, b sub 2. When we do the problem, we'll be like a, b, and then c, d, and so on, so that I don't have to verbalize so many crazy subscripts. And also, you know, subscripts are harder for you to write as well. So just use a, b, c, d, and so on as you write out your expansion of your partially decomposed fractions. So let's get to our example. So here we go. Last example. Case number 4. Repeated prime quadratic in the denominator, except that I don't have a quadratic, I have a fourth power. Just trying to keep my theme going here of maybe giving you an example that's slightly harder than at least the early questions in your homework. Getting to more like the medium to at least slightly difficult level. So this is not a quadratic, but as long as you have three terms, or when you have three terms, as long as your powers are reduced by halves, that is, or does have the possibility of being factorable. So as long as this will factor the same as x squared minus 4x plus 4. It's not a problem if this is an exponent of 4, as long as the middle exponent is half of 4, the power is half, and then you get to a constant. Or maybe it was 6, 3, and a constant. Or 10, 5, and a constant. Or even 7 and 7 halves and a constant. That's still factorable. Okay, so if you have a trinomial, and you know this is going to be a lot easier because our leading coefficient is equal to 1, or at least not as bad as it could be, factors of your first term go in your first two blanks, and the square root of x to the fourth is x squared. Square rooting will divide the exponents or powers by 2. That's why I was mentioning the halves pattern. And then factors of your last number go in your last two blanks. Now we're looking for factors of 4 that will either add or subtract, whatever the sign says, so factors of 4 that add to negative 4. And we are going to have both of these signs be negative. So what factors of 4 add to negative 4? Well, we got 1 and 4, but that makes 5, and we have 2 and 2. So we have x squared minus 2 and x squared minus 2. And it almost looks like we have difference of squares again, but 2 is not a perfect square. You could really argue, you could force the issue and write it as square root of 2, but we're not going to do that. So I'm going to take out this denominator that's to the fourth power and replace it with some quadratics, a repeated quadratic, a prime quadratic factor, which is x squared minus 2 to the second power. Okay, so we have a prime quadratic. If you don't want to force the issue and put in like square root of 2 there, it's not a perfect square. And it's repeated. It has a power of 2 on it. So we're going to walk through this process and call it a day. So what we're going to do is this is equal to, let's see, we have ax plus b. So ax plus b over x squared minus 2. And then repeat it. Ax plus b, but we're going to have to use a different constant, so cx plus d, and then x squared plus, whoops, minus 2, only now because we're in the second repetition of that factor, we're going to put an exponent of 2 on it. Now, we're going to multiply this through by the LCM, lowest common multiple, or just pretend like you're trying to find a common denominator. We're going to multiply this through by x squared minus 2 squared. All the way through, both sides of the equation. So this is of course going to cancel out, and we're left with x cubed plus 3x squared minus 4x plus 5. Only one of these x squared minus 2s are going to cancel out for this second term, so we're going to have ax plus b, wrapping that in parentheses because we'll have to distribute them together, and x squared minus 2. Then plus, now here, this is going to perfectly cancel out, so we're just left with cx plus d. Let's distribute this together. We get ax times x squared, which is ax cubed, and ax times negative 2, which is negative 2ax, then plus vx squared and minus 2b, plus cx plus d. Let's group those like powers together. We have ax cubed, well, there is none, it really isn't, there's not many anyway. We have ax cubed, we have plus bx squared, we have a couple of x terms, so we have minus 2ax plus cx. We have some constants here, negative 2b plus d. Okay, just checking my work because these are long and I'd hate to think I made a mistake. Good. Okay, so we can factor these x's out, and that's pretty much it. So we have ax cubed plus bx squared. Let's take out that common factor of x here, plus parentheses negative 2a plus c, that x that we factored out, and then plus, just, you know, grouping these together with the plus signs and just, you know, getting all those signs together, plus negative 2b plus d. Now, like last time, I'm running out of space here. We're going to take the factor, the leading coefficient, if you will, that is leading coefficient of the cubed term x, which is 1, and match it up with the a. We're going to take the coefficient for the squared term and match that up with b. We're going to take the leading coefficient of the x term, which is negative 4, and match that up with negative 2a plus c. And then finally, the constant of 5 being paired up with negative 2b plus d. Now when I say paired up, I mean I'm writing equations out, okay? So, well, let's get this system of equations set up and find these constants and finish this last example. Well, we got our boards cleaned up. There really isn't very much work left to do, though. We had those four unknowns and four equations, but thankfully, a couple of our equations don't have much going on. We have a equals 1 and b equals 3. So, even though we have four equations and four unknowns, we're already basically ready to start back substituting. So we're going to take this equation here, and using the a value of 1, we got negative 2 times our a value of 1 again, plus c is equal to negative 4, negative 2 plus c equals negative 4, add 2 to both sides, and we get c is equal to negative 2. Then, let's take our value of b, plug it into the last equation, and get negative 2, our b value is equal to 3, plus d equals 5, that's negative 6, plus d is equal to 5, add 6 to both sides, and d is equal to 11. So, our final answers, let's get this cleaned up here. Take this a, b, c, and d out of here, and we'll be done. A was equal to 1, so 1x plus b, which is 3. We had cx, so negative 2x, plus d, which is 11. And again, if you want to check your work and make sure that this is correct, take these two fractions, add them back together, make sure you get the original problem. Or if you're lucky enough to have a graphing calculator that'll do this, or a CAS style calculator, you can type that in and just sort of let it do the work for you, but you know, that's no fun. Bam! Mr. Taru, thank you for watching.